Are you ready for the Low Bros Network? It's the show where you control what's on the agenda. Ask us anything and we're both bound to answer. Sarah Rich Nash, Corporate King, and the Queen of Irish Wrestling, Katie Harvey. It's Ask Low Bros.
Bravo!
Hello, welcome to Ask Low Bros, the show where I ask you to send in questions about Allison Kay and NWA and how exciting that's going to be, and you didn't. So, cool. Anyway, I'm here with Rick Nash, I'm here with Katie Harvey. I'm just going to hop into the questions, even though I can't contribute to half of them because they're about TV shows, movies I've never even watched.
So don't have to take that personally.
Tony Kenny. Tony Kenny, who likes to be introduced as my number one fan. Tony Kenny.
Okay.
You need to pick 8 wrestlers to make up a dominant...
Can I just stop you there?
What?
Who are your top 5 fans?
What, top 5?
Like, if Tony Kenny's your number one, who's your top 5? Pick, rank, now.
Absolutely not, because that's how you alienate your fan base. I'm not doing that. This is strategy. You need to pick 8 wrestlers to make up a dominant scrum who makes it. So, is this rugby, yeah?
Yeah, Rugby World Cup started last
week. Okay, so... I'm going to throw out my 8, and you can agree, disagree, do whatever it is you want to do. But I assume you want big, strong lads in there, yeah?
Yeah.
What's a scrum?
It's where the rugby lads get together and make a massive octopus. It's like that. I don't know why they do it. I don't get the rules.
I thought they were just having like a pep talk. Is that an integral part of the match?
Like they have a pep talk where they go into the other team. That would defeat the purpose of a pep talk. Right, lads, what we've got to do, we can hear you.
I thought it's more so like, we are here to entertain these fans today.
That's not a word.
Does everyone know their spots? Call it once more before we go. 3, 2, 1, break.
Do you know, when I was a kid, I thought they went in head on head. Like, as in, like just head on each other. Like.
I know one of them's called a hooker.
Yeah, that's gas. Yeah. Can only imagine they're like a hooker.
That's the only thing I retained from rugby training in school.
I just played a bit of tag rugby, that was about it. But I do have my 8 scrums, if you're scrum diddly boys.
I pick Eric Rowan.
scrum diddly boys. that sounds creepy.
So, what are you saying?
I pick Eric Rowan.
Well, no, look, we're going to work as a team here, okay?
let's do draft rules.
If you didn't say that,
I pick Allison Kay.
Hey, that's my first 2, right? I'll tell you my 8, right? Surprisingly enough, Eric Rowan is number 1. Surprisingly enough, Allison Kay is also in there. Absolute tanks. Bobby Lashley, monster.
Yeah.
Mason Ryan, what a beast. Okay, who else I have in there? Liam Royal, Jazz, Justy, because weekly Justy mentioned. Justy.
Oh, we didn't mention him in the main zone.
We did.
And who do I have last? Rob Terry, because he was massive. And like he took a chair shot to the head one time, unprotected. Probably killed his brain, but he acted like it didn't even hurt, even though it clearly did. So I like Rob Terry. We're going to put him in there.
Okay. Who have you got?
Can I pick the same, or do I have to pick a different A?
You can pick some of them.
Okay, I want Eric Rowan.
Right.
I want Luke Harper. They're massive.
Yeah.
I want Batista.
Yeah, fair.
Do they have to be alive?
No.
Well, if they're dead, they wouldn't be much
like
use,
they wouldn't be very good.
Okay, I want.
But they're holding each other up.
They'd be declining as well. So it's like.
Beth Phoenix.
She's alive.
She's a commentator. Oh, I was thinking of China. Oh, she's alive.
I've got the visual in my head now. I've been doing this.
I'm so confused.
Holding her up, like, sorry. No, stop.
What we'll do is we'll draft in Asia from WCW.
Right.
Do you remember Asia? No. She was their China knockoff. Just a really big, muscly girl who wrestled as Asia.
I get it.
That is so cool.
Nakamura, he's quite big.
Is he?
He's out of everyone.
He's like 6'4". And knees people in the face a lot.
Yeah, but you're not allowed.
But that's like useless. Your knees are at the back of the scrum.
And also like...
Like, if you're going to throw a knee, you're going to knee yourself in the face or one of your teammates before you knee someone else in the scrum.
Out of all the big lads in wrestling, you went with Nakamura. All the big lads in wrestling. Every single
one. Like, you could have had Big Show.
You could have gone with Braun. Braun Strowman and you went with Nakamura.
Yeah.
Why?
I'm standing by this.
All right.
She's just digging her heels in now.
I'm also going to put The Miz there because... He's not the biggest, but you know what? I think he would be great for designing the costumes for the rugby team. And
costumes?
Because that's what the players in the scrum do. Guys, what do you think we should do for a fall outfit?
Sorry, is this not like School of Rock?
No, do you know what?
They all have a different job.
No.
No. They, all right, maybe they'll look really nice when they all get fucking knocked down and smacked around in the game. Fair enough. If that's your priority.
Liz is real sneaky as well, though.
That's again, it's like a very physical activity.
I don't think you can get away. That's all I think. I was like,
like you can't rake their eyes. Like,
all right, okay. Take out Nakamura and The Miz. Put in Goldberg and Kevin Nash.
That's a solid scrum.
Nash? Maybe he is prime.
Like, in his
he
prime.
He is in his prime.
He's on the decline.
There is no decline with Kevin Nash.
I think we need to explain
he
the
is
decline.
Getting stronger. He is having stem cell research to make him more beastly.
All right, well, for those of you that don't know, in career mode, in FIFA, when you play it, once you hit your 30s, early 30s, your stats start to decline. Kind of like Katie's in her early 30s.
I've just barely touched my 30s.
Well,
just
I mean,
put that out there.
The decline may or may not be starting. That's all we're trying to apply.
You brought this on yourself. Like, Keen was just explaining what the decline was, and Katie's like, does that mean I'm on the decline? And like, walked into yet another running
yeah,
joke.
Yeah, I was willing to not mention Katie. She just brought it up, so I don't know.
Yes, this is how it happens off air as well. It's the exact same. I've got one. I've got some.
Okay,
right.
Okay,
so people you want. Samoans. Lad, Samoans.
Oh, yeah.
Umaga,
yeah.
Roman Reigns. Like, Samoans are really good at rugby, too. Roman Reigns.
Jacob Fatu, the country unit lad.
Yeah, there you go. Basically, any Samoans ever. The Rock would be awesome in it. He's played American football. What's that?
Tamina.
No, I go Nia Jax before.
I think Tamina would be deadly. Actually, I think that's a great pick, yeah.
Whipping people in the face with a letter co.
Who else? So, Africans are good. Is there any South African wrestlers?
African Adam Rose.
No, not Adam Rose.
PJ Black. Adam Rose is jacked.
Nah.
PJ Black. Who else?
Nathan Jones.
Angelico. Is Jack Evans?
Nathan right? Jones.
Nathan
be good.
Jones, a beast. Yeah, yeah, get
yeah,
him in there.
There you go. Yeah, Australian.
Gene Snitsky.
Who's Irish?
Yeah, like
Seamus. Irish people are really good at rugby.
Yeah, but Gene Snitsky, and also he could be like, you know, like the kicker in.
Just mad for a punt.
As a baby, and he'll be fine. That's straight down the middle. Like.
Amazing. We're set for this. So, we got this.
That was a great question, but it's not his only question. He also... Oh, it's Queen versus Keen. Okay. So get your timer ready, I suppose.
Wait. Are we playing a team?
What?
Queen versus Keen.
Why is talk over this?
No, you're not throwing.
Oh, okay.
Well, it's happened now. Like, you kind of committed to it.
Well, here we are.
Why would you stop talking? You're allowed?
You see, now you've met, my momentum is kind of gone. I don't know what I'm doing. But yeah, so Kate, you can go first. I'll read it out, obviously. Right. With alter egos such as Yushin Liger to Kishin Liger, God Almighty to Temu Puki, happening recently, Queen vs. Keen is name as many WWE wrestlers pre-WWE names in 30 seconds.
Okay, Katie, you're up first. 30 seconds on the clock. Let's go. Go.
Jonah Rock. ACH. Your man Levesque.
Your man Levesque.
I don't think that was his name.
It have to be different names. Oh my god.
You got two when you're halfway through.
Chris Benoit, Dean Malenko. That's their pre-WWE names. Eddie Guerrero. I don't know. Is this in the rules? Miss Mona. I'm very confused. Axel Jim Duggan. No.
2-1. You got 6. And I gave you 3 of them out of pity.
There was not enough parameters on that.
Yeah, I should have explained. You can't just say, like, Chris and Wall when he's Chris. Like, that has to be, like...
Honestly, don't even know why that was the first
six.
Name.
No, I'm just going to bend the rules to give you 6, just be sound like...
Yeah, that's it, because I think this would be a short one. Right, Keen, it's not a case of if you win, it's a case of how long it'll take before you to win.
In 2 seconds and
you've got 30 seconds on the clock. Oh, do not slow down after 5, whatever you do. 30 seconds starts now.
Tyler Black, Torof Marius, Brody Lee, Claudio Castagnoli, Tommy N,
Big
Damo, Nicky Storm.
All right, you won. 7 seconds. 7 seconds.
Blaster Lashley was actually what you called in OVW. That was my next one. So.
Triple H's name in WCW.
Yeah, it was your man Levesque. Your man Levesque.
Terrorizing, that's what it was.
Terrorizing. You could have gone for John Paul Levesque.
Yes,
he was that
was
at one
in
stage.
My head.
Yes, yeah, that's what totally what
Miss
I was going to say.
Miss Mona and Jonah Rock were apparently just exactly where my head went.
Oh, NXT was a great one. I didn't even think going there. The whole breakout tournament, like, that's easy.
Miss Mona
like.
Was Molly Holly in WCW.
No, but I mean like ACH and all them, like they were all like John O'Rock.
That's funny because you called me out on that a few weeks ago, yeah. So I learned their names.
That's so funny to me still. I know, but thank you for that, Tony. I won again. I think, I don't know, if anyone would like to go back and count the amount of times I've beaten Katie in this, in Aslo Blows, it's something to one, which is quite a good record if you ask me.
It is.
Still the captain. Have I only won the Kevin Nash quiz?
No, this isn't that. That was a different game.
Oh, in that one?
In Queen vs. Keen, it's you won the first time I got to host Aslo Blows because I was overwhelmed with host duties on my first game. That's all it was. So yeah, thanks for the question. Tristan Carroll at Tristan M. Carroll sends in a question that I'll just read it out. I know what it means. When there are crossovers between different seasons of American Horror Story, why don't any of the characters notice other characters that look and sound exactly like each other?
Well, none of the characters actually crossed over to each other, have they?
It got ridiculous last season in Apocalypse because then they had the characters play several different people in different timelines.
But like Miss Meade, for example, she was dead before Cordelia came back.
Yeah, like, which was convenient.
Well, does Tristan mean like, why do other people not recognize that they look really alike?
Yeah, that seems like believable. Yeah, that seems like a believable thing. Yeah.
Tristan, if this is the most unbelievable thing you find about this show, I suggest you rewatch because it's batshit. Do we need to start listing off what happens in American Horror Story?
Well, last season was about the world ends and witches have to save it from evil warlocks.
I think they had to trick the warlocks.
They had to trick the warlocks because they're more powerful because Satan was a warlock.
Yeah.
But
he wasn't really a warlock because he was Satan.
Well, no, he was the Antichrist. He wasn't Satan. He was the Antichrist. Yeah. It's a big difference. It's a big thing. Which they teased in season one, where his mom was also three different characters in the series. And his dad was a plastic, like, gimp.
It was Tate dressed up as a demon. Tate was an undead spirit living in the house.
Yes. It wasn't Tate dressed up as a demon. It was a demon.
No, it was Tate.
Was it Tate?
Tate was the father. That's why Constance took care of the Antichrist.
But did they not think it was Tate, but it wasn't actually?
Was it not the house making Tate do it?
There's a lot of weird shit that happens on American Horror Story is the point, Tristan. We have to do an American Horror Story. I want to do... Next week, we're going to do a Walking Dead special in Nash. I want to do an American Horror Story special with you, where we just go through all of these.
Like, it is the character thing is getting ridiculous, though, because I was Wikipedia and some of the crossovers. Evan Peter played 7 characters on the last season. Yeah. 7 separate characters over 10 episodes. Like, that's insane.
At some stage, it becomes about them protecting their budget. And it's not even about the show anymore. It's about, like, let's just get the most out of Evan Peters. That's why he's leaving, lads. He's overworking the fuck out.
He's tired.
Like, yeah, this is it. Give the guy a break. Like, good for him taking a year off, although it's going to be weird without him. But I want to do that at the end of this series because I want to judge, like, how this series goes. So, yeah, it's an interesting one. It's just started. More questions about that, though, just for the confused, beleaguered look on Keane's face.
I agree. That's sweet. Sweet and sour fuck? who's that? It was probably someone new or something, I don't know. But, another fantastic question. Loads contribute here. Do you think this remake of It has done justice to the book and or the original movie? Do you think the new one is better than the original? I saw Chapter 2 at the weekend and I loved it because I found myself genuinely scared and tense, whereas I didn't with the original.
This new version of It surpasses both the book and the original TV show. By far. The book is great for about 2/3. And then you can tell how much cocaine Stephen King was on right in the end of it. Because, it goes mental. Like,
it's not a spoiler.
It ended with a child orgy. Like, and being buried in a hole with some sort of smoke ceremony. And then apparently some extraterrestrial turtle was actually responsible for everything. Luckily, they cut that bit from the movie and they rewrote it to make a really good ending that justifies the amazing characters he built up for the first 2/3 of the book. I still love the original because Tim Curry is Pennywise, but I just adored this new version of It, part one and part two. I just thought it was so well done. And like Nicola, thanks Nicola, you're a pal for sending this in, by the way.
I know.
she's like, I can't even breathe. I just loved it. It was tense. It was scary all the way through. But it was a really nice story.
Yeah.
And like, I know it was really good because I went with Phil, who detests horror films because he thinks they're shit. And he loved it as well because there was a story to it.
I rewatched the first one and then went to the cinema to see the second one recently. I absolutely adored the first one, and it was strange after watching. If you love this, you need to watch Stranger Things. You need to get back into that. You missed out. Like, it's I don't want to spoil it on you, but just like, give it 4 seasons.
That's a commitment.
No, there's three seasons so far, but the third season is genuinely one of the best. Like, everything hit, and it's building towards everything. Like, I'm genuinely like jumping up in front of the screen, like at times, like watching parts of it. Like, it's like they build stuff up and then they pay it off when you're not expecting it to pay it off. It's perfect. But you need to go back and watch Stranger Things if you love it, because when you watch it, you realize how much of a debt Stranger Things owes to it. Like, it's so similar. It's really similar. Like, and watch it with that in mind, where it's like, it's based off those kind of stories. And it's an homage to that. And I think you get an appreciation that you wouldn't have got the first time. But like, yeah, I loved it for the same reason. The first one was fantastic because it was like, it's a kid's story, and it's at its best when it's a kid's story. And it's fun and different because it's a kid's horror story. Like, it's a story where kids are genuinely getting horrifically murdered, which you don't see often, because it's like the whole like cliched 80s movie, which, and I don't mean cliched as an insult there, where it's like, it's a bad thing, because I grew up on these movies where it's like, kids are the real heroes and parents are so stupid. Those movies they made constantly throughout the 80s. But we watched them as cheesy kids movies. But this is one where there's an evil clown who's going to murder these children, and does murder a lot of children in it. Like, that's why it's cool. The originals just don't hold up these days, especially the second one when it becomes about the adults. They don't at all. The book, yeah, you nailed it with the book. The child orgy is just like Stephen King. I'm not sure if you're a paedophile or not now. That's a weird place to go, dude. But the second movie, I tweeted it out. I thought it was an excellent 90-minute movie in a 2.5-hour movie. I loved the movie in general. I thought the casting was so perfect for
Ben Handsome. There's a shout out.
Yeah, and he looks like the kid though.
Yeah,
like you can see the kid in him, like, but it's so spot on, and you can totally imagine that kid growing up to be that. That's realistic.
Yeah.
I loved how they adapted it for as well. Just a little thing I loved about it, how they adapted it for the, what is it, 27 years or 29 years, you couldn't spot 27 years. So it was like the 27 years started in like 1989. So it's still based in the '80s, whereas like in the 80s movie, the 27 years ended in the 80s. You know what I mean? I really like that. So they could do a modern movie set in the modern age. They nailed the casting of it. Bill Hader, brilliant as Finn. The storyline beats. The only problem I had with the second one was I think they were trying to be a bit too faithful to the book in some ways, and that they wanted to do it almost page by page. So there were a lot of repetitive moments where it's like, now it's doing something scary and haunting them, or they have to go back through their childhood and stuff like that. And it's like, yeah, you're just playing the same beats you played an hour ago.
Yeah,
like,
I think they should have trusted that we watched the first one recently.
Yeah.
And we remember what happened in it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know what I mean? So, but apart from that, I thought they nailed it. Like, I thought it was a really, when it hit hard, and it hit its spots really well. And like the cast makes and the characters make it. I was so worried about it because I just remember watching the original, and just like, I watched it like when I was older again, and I loved it when I was a kid because it was like the first horror movie that I saw. And I think for people our age who are on the decline, it is that kind of seminal movie. But like, I hated when the adults took over, because I'm like, this is a story about kids.
I loved it because it was still the kids' stories that had just transferred to their adult life. Beverly was still being abused, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
And like, you know, Ben is still struggling with like image and stuff. I loved it, and I actually thought they left too much out of the book.
But I loved the remake for that. Like,
oh, okay.
I thought they captured that in the remake.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because
the
they casted it so well. Whereas, like, in the, like, I watched the, did you ever watch Everything Wrong With? Did you ever watch those series? Oh, it's a brilliant YouTube series. Watch it. It nitpicks movies, but in a very funny way. And then they're like, they pointed out that Mike in the old movies was the da in Sister Sister. And I'm like, oh, yeah.
What?
Yeah, it was Raymond.
Yeah.
And it's just like, oh my God, they got this so wrong. Like, they didn't match the kids. Yeah. So that's where I felt they got wrong. That's what I was worried about this time, but they nailed it. And that's why the second movie worked. I enjoy it the more I think about it. Like, and now talking about it, I'm getting warm feelings for it. So
one little Easter eggy thing that I love, just because we were talking about the book. I love that when Bill was writing a screenplay, people kept making reference to, we hate the endings of your book. Rewrite it for screen.
Yeah.
Because that is the story of it.
Yeah.
It's an excellent book. People hated the ending. Rewrite it for screen. Yeah. A really nice little like Easter egg, I thought.
And
I
the fact that Stephen King is in the movie, oddly as the paedophile chemist, the fact that he's in it as well, kind of, that signs off on it. You know what I mean? It's not like he's like, okay, I get it. I get it. You know, so it's a kind nod, not a mean nod. Sorry, Keane. What did you think?
Yeah, I agree. Is that... We'll move on to the next one. At Simpsons WWE, in honor of Rambo, Last Blood, who's your favorite Sylvester Stallone character?
I didn't put these in a position to screw you. I genuinely didn't think of this game. The corporate keys.
I like Sylvester Stallone. Did he play himself in The Expendables?
It pretty much himself.
I hated that.
That was my answer.
Oh, what? I don't really remember the movie. I think I watched it when it came out. And I don't really remember it. It was just a load of action lads and doing action stuff.
That was it. Oh, no, I liked The Expendables as a whole because it just was what it was advertised. I just didn't like the Stallone character in it.
Oh, I did. I liked all of them. I just loved The Expendables. It's exactly everything I love about cheesy action movies.
Okay. That's fair enough. I just didn't... The only reason I didn't like it is because I knew he was writing it. It's like Triple H booking himself in the main event of Mania. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, but you go in knowing that. Yeah. Knowing he's going to be ridiculous about it.
But it's like, I do want to see the other guys too. You know what I mean? And it's just like, you're booking yourself here, man. It's just, it was Triple H it was. That's the only reason I didn't like it. For me, there's only one answer to this. It's Rocky. It's not debate needed. It's Rocky. It's the best character he's played. It's the one time he's actually done like... Well, no, Rambo is good. Rambo, he did acting. Yeah, I suppose. Because I don't consider action, like, action isn't acting. You know what I mean? It's a different genre unto
this
itself.
This is where we are going to disagree massively.
Okay.
Of course action movies are acting.
Okay, it's a different style of acting,
though. Is this like when people say deathmatch wrestling isn't wrestling?
No, yeah. But it's a
I'm with Katie on this one, believe it or not.
Like, okay, Con Air, right? One of the greatest acting performances of all time is Nicolas Cage in Con Air. You know, I still cry at the end of that film. I cry at the start of that film. I cry a lot during that film.
Right, okay. I agree with that. I agree. Go.
No, I'm just shouting film names that I love the people's acting.
I agree with both of those assessments, but they're acting in that movie. They're not playing it for cheesy laughs. That's a different genre. That's almost comedy more than acting. Do you know what I mean? Because like Arnold Schwarzenegger like doing catchphrases and stuff like that in like his 80s movies, which I love like to watch. They're very entertaining, but they're different. Do you know what I mean? They're not like it's not like you're not judging a great acting performance. He's never going to win an Oscar for that. It's not that it's invalid or not entertaining. It is, but it's not like acting. So if you're talking about his great acting roles, it's Rambo and it's Rocky, because they're the ones he had arcs in that he had to build towards and he had to tell a story through his performance. Whereas the other ones, a lot of the other ones are just kind of like, you know, he's playing a part. He's filling a role. He's like a comedic actor. He's there to hit his lines and there to do cool stunts. Like, it's not criticism. That's a valid form.
See, I think those people should get Oscars, comedies and action films
in their own right. Like, there should be like an action Oscars, you know what I mean?
That's like Golden Globe territory, where they split like best comedy actor, best
I'm not as far apart from this as well. Like, I realised that with the headline it sounded like I was doing a mad hot take, but like, no, I find it entertaining too, but it's a different genre, you know what I mean?
I'm just really obsessed with my 90s action films. I don't know if you knew this about me, I'm very passionate about
not having a go. I'm like, holy shit, I've awoken the sick declining lady.
This is the most alive I've felt all night.
Yeah, I feel like we're helping you recover here. Just wind her up. It works.
At Mr. Linda Block, John Kelly, another question.
I didn't do this on purpose.
Of course. In honor of the BH90210, I'm sure that means something to someone.
No, this is before my time.
Reboot. Fuck, marry, kill Kelly, Brenda, and Donna. Jenny Garth still has it going on. Is Jenny Garth one of those three people, or is that just an added comment?
I don't know.
I'm going to marry Kelly, because I'm sure she's a lovely woman. I will fuck Brenda, because I'm sure she's also a lovely woman. And I'll kill Donna, not because of anything against her, but just because it's, you know, just unfortunate the way she's just there. So
she isn't the third name, and it is fuck, marry, kill.
Either of you have anything to contribute to that?
I agree.
Wow, I really didn't think this set would turn out. I thought I'd be like...
Yeah.
What's BH stand for?
Beverly Hills.
Oh.
Now, I need to keep pointing out when he sends these questions in that I am straight and do not find any of these women sexually
attractive.
That's
what fuck, marry, kill's about. Fuck, marry, kill is not a sexual thing.
It absolutely
Keen
is.
Had to,
it
like...
absolutely is.
Keen had to have sex in front of a rubber duck before.
Yeah, that was my...
Because he committed to the bit with, like, what's his name?
Leo Gao.
He had to have sex with Leo Gao in front of a rubber duck.
30-something Chinese man.
It's not a sexual thing.
I'm having more than hype flashbacks from Saturday. I just don't like it, okay?
It's not a sexual thing.
Exactly, if it was a sexual thing...
Don't be weird.
It is a sexual thing. You're saying you want to have sex with these people.
Yeah, but that's...
He doesn't want it. He has to.
Look, focus on
it's sex you. Under duress.
It's tactical, right? Fuck is the one you leave till the end. Marry is like who you love the most in a completely platonic way, who you like the most or who you want to see succeed. You want to keep them alive, you want to hang out with them, and then kill is who you hate, whatever. So fuck is just the default one that you
Why can't
at the end.
We put Luke Perry in there though?
Because I don't know who that is.
He's also from that show, I believe.
Oh, well.
He's dead, it'd be weird. It's necrophilia.
Yeah, that's
well,
weird.
I thought about
Keen having sex under duress, but somehow you made it weird.
Yeah. but thanks for the question nonetheless, John. I appreciate it. Can't believe I'm the one who contributed the most to that.
Well, you were due.
Nevertheless, @Scott_Aspill, thank you, Scott. Thank you so much. Shout out to Scott. Loving the question. Thank you so much, because it's a wrestling-related question. Lads, I am so excited to answer this, just because it's about wrestling. Do you think that ratings will be as big of a deal-breaker for AEW and NXT as it was back in the Monday Night Wars, or will social media mean more in this age? What do
I don't know if either of them are the biggest factor. I think VOD is the biggest factor on all of this.
Are
we counting that with ratings?
I disagree. I think
let it flesh it out. I'd say
I don't know how to flesh this out. like I don't know. I don't really follow the inner workings. Yeah. You know what I mean? I don't know how either of them plan on making the biggest chunk of their money. It's probably advertising, so maybe ratings is actually the biggest factor. Mm. I don't know. I'm very confused. I'm sorry.
I think ratings are still like the bread and butter of the whole thing. I think like. A lot of fans like to overlook it and say, oh, but social media this and social media that. And, like, yeah, social media can get you a big buzz for, like, a little bit. But it's, like...
How many people actually watch wrestling live, though? Maybe it's different in America because it's on at reasonable
time. Yeah, exactly, yeah.
But over here, like, I watch it on the network. You know, I watch the replays. I watch it on catch-up.
And AEW doesn't have a TV deal over here. I think we need to point that out today. Oh, did they?
They announced, I think it's a 60-minute highlight video.
Ah, shit.
On ITV 6 days after it airs in America.
Yeah.
That's awful.
So we're all going on torrents, yeah?
I'm on Team NXT then, I guess, in this war. At least they made it like accessible, I suppose.
But you see what I mean? Like, it's like, what are their ratings going to be like over here?
Well, the ratings over here don't matter. I didn't clarify that. When I say ratings, I mean American ratings. I don't think the ratings internationally matter as much. They obviously do matter a little bit, but not. I wouldn't say like the US is the main market. Like that's where the war is happening.
But aren't they drawing bigger crowds when they travel for shows?
Have AEW done a show outside America?
Well, I'm thinking about WWE more so. Like if they do a European tour, would that draw more people than if they just did their regular American loop?
I doubt it. Would it?
If they did a tour, no, I don't think so. No, because AEW, what they're doing is they're quite clever, and they're trying to maximize like a small internet fan base. Like they get like 500,000 hits for like consider that like for example Baron Corbin videos on Raw, like a generic backstage promo gets like 1.5 million hits on YouTube, and they get 500,000 hits for like a big Be in the Elite episode, like which is their bread and butter, like. So they're trying to maximize that, like, and they can't, like, they're talking about, like, not doing house shows for a while at least, and that's why, because they can't. If they tried to do a tour, like, this is the thing that everyone wanted to buy into the AEW hype train, and they're like, you know, well, AEW are selling out, like, and it's like, yeah, they're selling out, like, one show that they have, like, 3 months to promote, and it's their only show that month, whereas and they're like, well, WWE haven't sold out their pay-per-view. It's like, yeah, but that's the fourth WWE live event that week. It's different, like, so, it's tough. Ratings will be important, because if they don't get good enough ratings, they get cancelled, and if they get cancelled, they've no, like, route to market, and then they're fucked. They're not the be-all, end-all, though, like, and ultimately as well, like, what counts in this war if both sides are doing enough ratings is, like, they matter more for AEW, because if AEW lose to NXT, which I think they will, I think NXT, WWE just have a much bigger reach than AEW, like, they just, they hit more homes, they can advertise on both the USA Network and Fox, much bigger networks than AEW is on, so they have a bigger reach, so I think if they lose, like, if they're getting their asses kicked by NXT, which they might, it's going to be, like, it'll make them look really shit. So that's, the perception will be bad. But ultimately as well, what's worth taking into account is it's 2019 and facts don't matter anymore. People are going to pick their side and they're going to cherry pick the specific things that suit their argument and they're going to make up their mind no matter what. They're going to decide this before it even starts and everything they see is going to be seen through that lens. And that's what's going to matter as long as the two are.
Yeah, I completely forget what I was going to say now. I definitely had something to say as you were talking, and it just completely escaped me. But, like, yeah, how mad it'd be if, like, one of them gets cancelled, well, presumably it will be AEW. Oh, now I remember what I was going to say. Thank you. Right. How, I never took into account how, like, we can, like, check the ratings and see, like, who won that week. I completely, that's, like, the most exciting part now. I've never, in my lifetime, I never got to do that. Like, with WCW or, you know, WWE, I never got to do that. Now I get to be, like, I know, again, it's not, it might not be as important as it was back then, but it's still, like,
well, like, if it's an anyway decent contest, that could be really interesting, because then you can look at the quarterlies and you can break down, like, during this segment, like, people switched over to this station and stuff like that. That's what made the Monday Night Wars really fascinating, when it was, like, 50-50, because it was, like, The Rock is on, so the ratings spiked for WWE, but then Goldberg was on the next segment, so the ratings went back to WCW. Like, it could be that, like, it has the potential to be, but what's more likely to happen for me, the most likely thing, and probably the most boring answer is, like, within a few weeks, you're going to start saying, AEW say, hey, guys, we didn't want to be competition. When we said we weren't scared, it's because we're not trying to compete. We're just trying to be an alternative. It's going to happen the exact same way it happened to TNA, I feel. No, maybe a bit stronger than TNA. I don't think it's going to be a shit show. But, yeah, in terms of the public gesturing, where it's like, we very much want to be competition, and then they get their asses kicked, and then they're like, we were never trying to be competition, and that's going to kill their credibility a bit.
I do fear that it's going to be, like, a, like, very good quality version of World of Sport. That's my fear. Where it's like, I just haven't seen much buzz for it in the weeks coming towards their debut.
It's not over here. I think there is in America.
Like, it could be. I might not see it, you know what I mean?
Like, because we're just not part of that, especially in Ireland as well, like, because we still have that latent heat with them from when they fucked up that OTT show.
I think most people have kind of...
But,
move,
like,
on a bit.
It's not even that we're
justice for Foxy.
Yeah, that's fair.
It's not even that we're still angry. It's that, like, they haven't won us back. They haven't got us, like, going, D-Elite, B-D-Elite. They haven't got those people back. Like, they're, like, people just are like, nah, whatever. I'm a bit over them.
Yeah, I'm kind of the same. Like, I really want them to succeed, but, I don't feel anything when I see the Elite, you know, kind of way. I never really did. But, like, hey, yeah, I know. We'll just...
Well, I think we're out of that loop, too, over here. I think in America, there is a very strong people who will, like, live or die for them. They're
so.
Like, I cut myself for you, Cody.
Okay, no,
you
know, I don't hope that.
I think it is down to the reach, like you were saying. I was watching NFL in the Woolshed last week, and in the space of, like, half a game, I seen 5 ads on Fox, the one you were talking about.
Yeah.
Like, me and Phil were sitting there, like, that's Becky's face that's being shown every 40 minutes. On, like, primetime American telly. Yeah. Like, I remember when I went to America and I went to 7-Eleven and, like, you got your Slurpees in, like, WWE cups and stuff. We forget how big a reach they do have.
Just even, like, little things. You go into Tesco or something in the kids section and there's, like, you know, WWE, like, fucking books or, like, you know, like, just little things. It's all there. Like, you just don't realize it.
Yeah.
Like, AEW, not just AEW, but anyone who would ever want to compete at that level, that's such a long way to go.
But you can't underrate how, like, for example, they're in Hot Topic. So that's the equivalent of, like, they have merch, Bullet Club t-shirts for sale are in Hot Topic. That's like having Bullet Club t-shirts for sale in Pennies. like where they have like Harry Potter and Game of Thrones stuff. You know
I
what I mean?
I think their head is kind of in the right. I think they are thinking along those lines. Yeah. You know
what I mean? But no, they do already. Like before AEW even started, they had these for sales and Hot Topic. So that's a big deal. So they're not that far behind. There's part of me that feels they overreached and went a bit too far too soon. As well, something to take into account is the cans are a big deal because like Cody and the Young Bucks and Kenny Omega's power is prevalent on them still being like, keep in mind what happened in TNA where it's like 1 week this person's running it, this person's running it. Tony Khan is the boss here, you know what I mean? And if shit goes wrong, then he can just fire all of those guys and restart because ultimately he'll be like, this is my wrestling promotion and I'm the one paying for all this.
That would be fascinating. That would be like but fascinating.
It could happen if it goes tits because like he's like, this is me making my move and I'm a millionaire. But also as well, then we have to take the Cans history into account. Jacksonville Jaguars. Not a lot of people know this unless you like NFL. Not a very good football team. Not a very well-run football team. Fulham. Very badly run football team. What did Fulham do in the Premier League last year? They poured millions into all these superstar signings.
They signed Cyrus Christie, which I thought was a very good thing to do, and it just didn't work out for them. But look, they're doing all right.
What did the Cans do? They changed owner managers 3 times in the 1 season. They changed owners.
That's them making the
yeah,
seconds.
That's even, them. That's them. That's them. They poured millions into these superstar signings, tried to get a quick fix solution and get Fulham promoted. It went tits very quickly and they just kept changing the ownership. That's the Cans. We should be looking at that and learning from it. But also as well, we're not because Dave Meltzer is their mate and he's the one we look for news. So none of that is being fed back to us. So no one's even thinking about it. But it's worth it. There's a lot to take into account here.
There's a lot... You can do a whole podcast on like AEW and the whole upcoming thing. It's actually very interesting stuff. So thanks a lot for that question, Scott. It was fun actually having a discussion.
Keith's just like, I'm really happy to be involved.
Oh man, no, because I went on my phone when he was talking about it. Thanks, Nicola. And it was all Brexit talk and stuff like that. It really got me down. So I'm glad to be back into the wrestling.
Yeah. Let's just bury ourselves in that. It's gonna be a rough month ahead.
That's actually fascinating in its own right. But you'll never know. We'll save it for another week. At Killer Steve W asks, is AEW focusing so much on NXT as? Yeah, sorry. Is AEW focusing so much on NXT from comments of Omega, etc., as their competition a huge win for WWE, and are they doing exactly what WWE want them to do? We have kind of already discussed this on the main show.
We touched on it, yeah.
We basically said, yeah. I was like, you know, where it's like they've changed the narrative. It's not WWE versus AEW. It's more like NXT versus AEW now. So, I mean, yeah, you could argue. Probably, yeah. Use both.
Yeah, that was my point on the main show, that... Yeah, it's NXT they're battling, and that's their developmental territory, so yeah. They're not really battling WWE.
Yeah, and as well, like, by aiming their shots at NXT, this is one point that I meant to make, but I didn't. By aiming their shots at NXT, they're aiming their shots at the most likable people that, like, their market care about. So, like, they're not aiming at, like, if they were taking shots at Baron Corbin, like, open season. It's like, just wail on him, and their fans would be like, yeah, he's everything we hate about WWE. But now you're taking shots at, like, Matt Riddle and Walter and, like, people like.
And the gas thing is, it's just going to force WWE to do cooler shit on NXT.
Yeah.
Because that's how the Monday Night Wars works.
And honestly, that's the main reason I want AEW to succeed. I don't really care about their show that much. It's just I want to see how far WWE will go in response. And that's why this is so exciting. Now we have The Fiend, Eric Rowan, fucking NXT, you know what I mean? It's all going.
Like,
it's
they've
all
already
going
brought up Pete Dunne and Walter, like the heavy hitters from NXT UK. Yeah. They've brought in the 205 Live guys.
Leo Rush is back! Yes.
So they're pulling out all the big guns. Like, they're sending main roster lads back to NXT. Like, they're.
And think about when Bobby Lashley comes back. He's probably gonna get a world title run, possibly. You know what I mean? Like, there's so many possibilities. They're doing a draft. They're doing a fucking draft. Sorry.
It's so exciting.
I've never.
You're getting me much more excited. As well.
I am buzzing. Like, this. Yeah. Like, I think this is the most excited I've been for like a non. Kind of Irish wrestling show or set of shows ever. Like, yeah. Thanks a lot for the question, Steve. At Jack E. Hook, shout out to Jack Hook. I know he watches all my videos, likes them. Corporate Keen, bringing in those international listeners. So,
but he's not your number one fan, is he?
He might be. See, I don't know.
Oh,
don't
so Tony's
know.
Not, is
I
he not?
I don't know. Leave me alone.
Who's your number one
stop
fan?
Trying.
Who's
I'm
your
really
favorite fan?
Stop ruining it.
This is what happens when you host. We turn it on you.
But Jack asks, and this kind of ties into what we were literally just getting at a second ago. Favorite things about wrestling in 2019 so far? So, I mean, like, I don't know about you, but for me, off the top of my head, I can give you loads of answers. Like, Becky winning the Royal Rumble, Cody versus Bryan at WrestleMania, Devin Walter, Rowan turning into a fucking star, AEW versus the NXT. There's so much. CNF becoming a double champ and becoming the face of NWA. NWA coming back. MLW rising up. So many promotions. There are so many things going on in wrestling right now.
You haven't even brought up, like, Walter Devlin.
I literally just said that.
Oh, did you? Sorry.
It's okay. But I brought up so much there that I literally just slipped under the radar. Because, like, that's the thing. It's such a fucking stacked year for wrestling. Even though, like, I know, like, British wrestling might not... But even with British wrestling, you got, like, the Riptides and the Shiden for the boys, you know, their show. And that actually just sold out in 4 minutes there. They've got, like... Now, it's a small setup, I think, but it's still, like, it's hot now. You know what I mean? It's another cool, hot thing happening. So even with all the British wrestling scandals and drama, that's still... It's still a much better scene than what it was, like, a decade ago. You know what I mean? Let's not lose sight of that either. So there's a lot going on. I can't give you one. I gave you loads. But what about you? What are your favorite things?
Do you know what I love about wrestling 2019? There's always something. Every week, there's something to look forward to. Do you know what I mean? And it feels like there's constantly something big happening. It's a real, like, and if it's not, like, I love doing low blows in 2019 because it's, like, every week, like, last week was a real Irish wrestling show. And we talked about Phoenix on the show, but we barely touched on Irish wrestling in that show. And there's so much else going on, you know what I mean? Like, there's always something to look forward to, like, and then you forget about other things, like, OTT's coming back and it's put on a big show, and you're like, oh yeah, fucking OTT, and then New Japan is, like, the G1, you're like, oh yeah, New Japan, and then it's, like, AEW, and it's, like, oh yeah, and then it's, like, oh, NXT's class, oh, like, there's UK TakeOver, like, you know what I mean, there's always something week after week after week. It's a fucking class year for wrestling. WWE coming back and being relevant and entertaining on a consistent basis is a huge thing as well, I think, because now, like look at the things they're hitting out of the park. Becky, this is the year of Becky, and the year Bray Wyatt has been resurrected, and then, like, there's Eric just Rowan. Eric Rowan, Kofi, you know, there's so much stuff as well that they're doing. That's really cool, like, because you need a strong WWE or wrestling. Like, it just pulls down the rest of wrestling because it's, like, that's the biggest company in the world. There's always something to be excited about. What I want to know is, like, yeah, like, this has been a weird wrestling year for you because then there's the personal, like, highs and lows. Like, so I want to know your...
Yeah, well, like, okay, I didn't watch wrestling at the start here.
Yeah.
I was dabbling. But I got to go to a lot of live shows, which is cool. So I got to be there in the crowd for matches I mightn't have normally seen from the crowd. Things like Devlin Starr. Like, that match when it went on first, I marked it. I got so excited. Like, I really loved that moment. I loved... My favourite is Michael May and Jonathan Gresham.
Yeah, we didn't even talk about
just
that.
Just because, like, personally, that was such a big thing for us to put on. And then I loved the match. And it's just where everything clicked. And, like, that was such a big coup for us. Like, that was Fight Factory's big defining moment. Yeah, we just have people... Like, the WWE tryout for all the girls. Yeah. We forgot about
so
that.
So much shit.
You know what I mean? Like, we had Debbie Keitel on NXT last week.
Yeah. Oh, what the hell? That feels like a year ago.
You know what I mean? Like, and even new things starting again. Be Cool's videos at the moment. I can feel it in my gut. That's leading somewhere massive.
Yeah.
You know, that's the start of something special. Yeah. There's constantly something brewing, and it's deadly.
Yeah, it's amazing. It is. It's awesome.
It's the best time to be a wrestling fan. It's the best time to have a wrestling podcast.
Yeah.
And, yeah, thanks a lot for the question, Jack. That was actually a daily question.
Yeah.
At Hender the Great... Coming down from up north for my first Dublin OTT weekend next month, apart from the shows, name one thing I should do. Cue for the show. Think about the show. Talk about the show. And go to Spire and get some Pringles. It's Stadium, yeah? That's the next one? Or is that where he's coming down for?
Stadium, I assume it's Stadium, yeah.
There is a Spire down the road, and they do Pringles normally around €2, €2.50. I'd recommend them personally. They enhance the experience. And I don't really actually do anything else besides go to wrestling shows, so I don't really know. Would either of my more experience.
Katie's more culture. You're more culture than me.
Well, just like probably don't spend your entire weekend on the South Circular Road.
Yeah,
like that's go to the city centre and see some stuff because Dublin is beautiful. Have you ever brought someone who's never like to Dublin for the first time?
Melina.
No, like that wasn't a question. Well, it was, but like, would you ever walk around Dublin with fresh eyes? Like, I only moved into the city 4 years ago.
Yeah.
And like, I still wander around getting excited. Like, where we are right now. Do you know the story behind all the alleyways here?
No.
So there's a place called the Icon Factory, which has painted murals on every alleyway in Temple Bar, and each one is a different story. The one beside us now is the Dangerous Woman aisle. And basically what it is, if you go look at it, it's murals of all these really like cool women throughout Irish history, what they did and who they were. There's another one for musicians. There's another one for actors. Like, that's something completely free that you can wander around and do in Temple Bar. Like,
that's really cool.
It is really cool.
Fuck, that's daily.
But like, I realise all this now because I was new to Dublin. So I wandered around the city. Like, I work in Temple Bar. So literally on my hour lunch break for the first year, I would just wander around. I would just pick a new street and go wander down it.
Mm.
Like, check out new cafes and stuff. Do that. Just wander.
Yeah. That's a really nice answer.
When you said that,
I thought, like, the amount of, when I think it's like, have you ever taken anyone around Dublin? I think it like Tinder dates. Because when like I was like, when I lived in town, I don't really do it anymore. Like, I've grown up a lot. But when I lived in town, like, I used to get bored, like, on, say, a Tuesday or a Wednesday, and it'd always be someone traveling that you could match with. And they're like, take me on a tour. And then they'd always go, I want to go to Temple Bar. And I'm like, oh, I'm not buying a drink there.
There's cool parts of Temple Bar, though.
There is cool parts, but like, and don't get me wrong. When you see, like, if you go there on like a busy night, and like you see the buzz and the banter that we miss out on, like, ultimately, like, yeah, we're here a lot. We tape here, you know what I mean, and whatnot. So, like, we see it regularly, but at the same time, when you're seeing it through those eyes, it is cool and there is a buzz. But then you go in and it's like €70 for a round, yeah. And you're just like, all right.
That's why you buy cans and you walk up to the college right. Or Stephen's Green and you sit there.
Here's something you can do. Go to, this is what I'll do. Like, no, not, don't do it in October, but if you're ever in Dublin on a summer's day, go into Trinity and go to sit on the green with cans. Yeah. And it's awesome. Like, and you're allowed. Like, that's what it's there for. Like, and it's an awesome way to spend a day. Like, you start do with Nicholas sometime. Really nice day out.
Yeah.
There you go. I know you don't drink cans, but sit on the green with Pringles.
Drink Yops and Pringles.
Also, yeah, the Leprechaun Museum is gas. It's really cheesy, but it's gas.
The Wax Museum, don't do it. It's expensive and a waste of your life. Fair. It's like literally just wax versions of famous people. Like,
but it's funny though. You ever see some of the wax, the recent ones of like, who was it? Was there one of McGregor recently? And it was just like,
they don't look like anyone.
Yeah. Well, I'd actually recommend it. No, I wouldn't. I'd recommend queuing from about 6 in the morning. The last question though comes in from at Bittersweet Chinam. I assume that's Keith. That's Keith, yeah?
Keith, yeah.
So I'm just going to say Keith because it's easier to say. Keith, I fucking love this. but I'm going to read it out. So, with fantasy NFL in full flow, how would you three feel about doing a fantasy wrestling draft? If there's genuine interest from the three of you, I'll do up the rules and keep scores. I can only speak for myself. Personally, I fucking love this idea. I don't do fantasy NFL. I do fantasy, like, Premier League. I follow that every week. I'm constantly updating it. As the weeks go on, I get shitter and shitter progressively. But wrestling, that's a fascinating one to do. Because it's not even like, oh, pick a main eventer. It's like, pick who gets the wins. Like, who goes... you might pick Rollins, but if he's a champion and he's getting beaten up on Raw every week only to win the pay-per-view, but it's a pay-per-view match worth more? I don't know. Keith makes the rules. So, like...
I spend a lot of time. I spend about 6 months trying to... Like, because I love all these things. Like, we do prediction leagues all the time, like, and I've got a real kind of match head, so I've got a good head for that stuff. I did it, and we ran into problems because it's, like... the reason that, like, I wanted to develop an app and I wanted to, like, make it a worldwide thing. Like,
so cool, dude.
Yeah, I know, but we ran into problems with it because it's like, I realized that when I ran the numbers, because I started, like, keeping score myself and, like, did mock drafts myself and just started, like, what would the scores be like? And it's like, it's so, like, and it's kind of the flaw with, like, fantasy football as well, but in wrestling, it's really pronounced. If you have certain people, you just win. Do you know what I mean? Like, if you have a person who happens to get pushed, you win. And it's like, do you do it based on year? Do you do it WrestleMania to WrestleMania? Do you do it based on, like, when do you do it and who do you pick? And also, like, because it's a fixed sport, it's really easy to pick who's about to get pushed and who's going to get lots of wins. And it is easy to pick, like, who's that person who's on Raw every week who'll get you the easy wins.
Wait, by the way, so he's talking about the NFL where you can't have the same... person, am I right in saying that?
Yeah, so if you get that person, you win.
But if we're doing it the Premier League football, where it's like your own team and you can have whoever you want, but obviously there's like a budget and there's like transfers and stuff, would that be better?
Will we give it a go? Keith said he'll keep score.
I mean, if it's Keith, if Keith wants to put the weight of that on his shoulders, like, by all means, I'd absolutely be up for that. But if there needs to be a draft, if it's a draft, then we can't have the same... So I get your point.
Can we just not pick 10 people now?
We'll pick, well, right. So I'd say we go 5 people each. Let's keep the workload light.
No, no, we can't do it now.
Let's do it right now, right this second.
Yeah, on the spot. Oh, that's the point, yeah. We have to finish off. This is the last question. This is the main event.
Are we restricting it to Raw, SmackDown, NXT?
I don't know.
AEW, New Japan.
What?
One from each.
Wait, it's outside WWE as well?
Yeah, one from each.
Oh, wow.
One from each, okay.
But you also have to weigh up then as well. I think we have to go away and plan this.
Yeah, you can't.
If we restrict it to something like NXT, for example, where it's a more even playing field between the people on it.
But you don't know who's going to be on every week.
Yeah, yeah.
You watch NXT every week. I see what you're trying to do there, Harvey.
Yeah,
I see what you're doing there.
No, I think we should do it real niche. Do it like CHW backyard. Like, no, I think we should definitely like plan this. Like,
okay. So we're gonna finish it. We're like tune in next week. We're gonna do a to be continued finish. Blows.
Thanks a lot for the question, though, Keith.
We've got people really hyped for it. That's a great idea. Let's do it. And they're just gonna be like, tune in next week.
And next week, we'll be talking about The Walking Dead. So
tune in 2 weeks.
2 weeks from now.
Which will be the draft week.
Oh, that's appropriate. Well.
It'll be the day of the draft. It'll be
that.
Released.
Look at that.
There we go.
Boom. Absolutely, 100%.
I'm all keen.
So on that note, thanks a lot for your questions. Not the ones who asked about movies. I didn't appreciate that at all. No, I didn't appreciate it. I actually appreciate all the questions. Genuinely helps let the show out and all that. And thanks. Bye.
Who's your favourite fan, though?
My favourite fan?
Name it now in the last section. No one's listening to the end.
Okay. My favourite fan is... End it, Rick! You're meant to hit the stop button. That's the point. I'm pointing at the laptop.